Well, good afternoon.
Ooh,
yeah, got my big voice on today. One of the occupational hazards of being a pastor, at least this is what I think is an occupational hazard of being a pastor. It could just be an occupational hazard of being me, which is could be part of it. Is I am a people watcher. I don't know if you're a people watcher or not, but I am a people watcher. I love watching people. It is just so fun to see what's going on. And I was a former teacher, and so I've got really good hearing. So I can usually pick up multiple conversations at the same time. And it's not that I'm eavesdropping on you. I might be, but it's that's not my point. I'm just watching people, and I'll listen to them. So when I'm in a mall or something like that, I can hear multiple conversations going on, and I'll focus in on one and listen to them. And listen to people talk and watch them. And no matter what I'm doing, I'm probably watching or listening to people. And Susan and I went to the Tides the other day for lunch, and we had never been there before. It was our first time in 17 years of living here, 16 years of living here. We finally made it to one of the icons in Gig Harbor. And I just got to tell you that the St. Louis burger with the blue cheese, oh, it was really good. It was really good. But we were sitting at this little table outside, and because it's all crowded in there, and it was nice enough outside. We actually hadn't even planned to go out to lunch, but it was so nice outside. We were able to sit outside at the table. And there were all these groups out there on this little deck sitting at these tables having lunch. And so I began to, you know, focus in, just doing my thing. And I was listening to the different conversations. One that was kind of interesting was that right next to us was a pastor meeting with a student leader. And they were talking about, I don't know if it was a, I couldn't figure out whether it was a teenager or college ministry. But he was sitting there talking with them, and they were visioning about it. I said, you know, and I know this is summertime. And I could just hear him talking. And he was a pastor. I knew he was a student leader in a ministry. And they had a great conversation. And I thought, wow, that is so neat. You go to a tavern, and you find multiple pastors. Praise the Lord. That was pretty fun. But then there were other people that I was listening to. It was pretty interesting. For instance, I watched the waitress. Now, I don't know if you ever watch waitresses. There's good waitresses and bad waitresses, right? And some of the good waitresses, I mean, the really good ones, they know how to interact with people, right? You always feel comfortable with them. And it doesn't matter what kind of person you are, the waitress can interact with you. And this person that was working there, she was great. She was really good. So she went over to one table, and she just mirrored the kind of people that they were. So as they talked to her, she would talk to them. You know, so there's some people that are a little bit boisterous. So she'd be a little boisterous with them. And then when she came over to get our meal, she kind of calculated that we were quiet people. That's mostly because I was listening to everybody else. But she kind of figured that we were quiet, and so she was just quiet with us. And then she went over to some regulars, and she reflected them, too. And it was just really interesting. She was masterful at what she did. And as I began to think about that, I was just sitting there, and I just wondered out loud, not out loud, but in my mind, I thought, you know, I wonder how many people around me know Christ. Now, I felt pretty good that there was a pastor having a conversation with a student leader. That felt pretty good. I thought, okay, those two know that. But what about the others? And you know what? As I listened, I don't believe a number of them did. For Christ at all. And I wonder, do they have a church home? And I probably could guarantee you that most do not. Most of the people that I ate lunch with that day, we shared an hour and a half of beautiful Gig Harbor sunshine and some incredible food, they don't have a church home. And after I left that establishment and left those people, nothing had changed. Nothing had changed about that. Now, it wouldn't have been effective for me at that moment to stand up and say, cling, 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 you know, I just want to tell you about the gospel. Right? That would not have been an effective moment. It might have been a memorable moment, but it would not have been effective. And say, I just want to tell you about Jesus Christ and you know, invite you to my church. That wouldn't have worked. There at that all. So I understand that. But here's the problem. as I look at how I go through life, most of the time, I'm going into these situations where there's people all around me. And when I leave those situations, the people that are all around me are completely unchanged. It is as if I was not even there to them. I had zero impact on them at all. Nothing changes. I come into connection with people, and I stay at my table, and I say nothing. I watch and maybe comment later, but nothing changes. I go to the grocery store, the same thing happens. I'll go by people, and I'll see people, and I'll walk by people, and maybe I'll say hi, or any of those kinds of things, but nothing changes. I went and had the leaf service the other day, which is, you know, all it involved was rotating the tires and they checked the battery. That's kind of, I like that, okay? I just think that's great. And they also reprogrammed the brakes because evidently they were coming off in the cold weather, like we had any of that. So anyway, there was those kind of things, and I was sitting there in the waiting room. When you have a car service, they have these lovely little waiting rooms. They have Wi-Fi, so I can stay connected to, you know, Facebook and all this kind of stuff. And so I was sitting there, and then, you know what I did? I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll just bring a nice audio book, and I'll just sit here and close my eyes and relax and just enjoy an audio book while they're servicing my car. And it took about an hour for them to do that. And, you know, it was foolish for me to do that. I thought about it later. Here I had a captive audience. These people couldn't get in their cars and leave. Right? They were up on stand. And they couldn't leave. They couldn't flee anywhere. There was nowhere to go because if you go outside, the salesman attacked you. Right? So they needed to stay in the doors. Like, don't go in the long grass. Don't go out by the cars. I have. And what did I do? I listened to an audio book. Wow. And nothing changed. You know, sometimes we get complacent, even comfortable with our own inaction, don't we? With our own inaction. See, today I want to talk with us, with you, with me, about being invitational. Invitational. I want to talk about what it means to be invitational, but mostly, and most importantly, I want to talk to you as to why we should be invitational. Why? You know, Vision 2020, we talk about being a church of 300 plus, and it's really easy to miss the heart of that. Really easy to miss the heart of that. Maybe you think, oh, well, he just wants to have a big church or some kind of nonsense like that. If you get to know me, you realize that that's not it. If I'm honest, it'd be a lot easier to keep a small church, amen? Right? You have 300 people, that's a mess. There's going to be all kinds of stuff. I'm going to be busy. I'm going to have really long office hours. People are going to be calling me all the time. We have a church of 300. That's a lot more work for me. So it's really not about me. Some might hear me talking about a church that is so big and think, well, it's just ego trip. He's trying to have a church that's this big. Listen, what I want to tell you is when I talk about having a church of 300, I'm limiting it to 300. That's the idea, is that it's the limit size of 300. That's the idea. So why mention numbers at all? If people can so easily mistake what I'm saying and think that it's about an ego trip or it's about this or that or it's about money and tithe or anything like that. But why even mention numbers? I'll tell you why. Because it is simply a measure of effectiveness. It's a measure of effectiveness. They are a target, not for brownie buttons or because I get an upgrade in heaven. You know, oh wow, he had this size shirt. You get the custom deluxe size mansion. You know, it's not like that. That's not what it's about. It's a measure of the kind of impact we're having on our community. That's what it's about. It's a measure of the kind of impact we're having on our community and the kind of impact we're having on the world. So when I talk about 300 plus, I see that as a limit, not some lofty goal. And that's to say we want to limit the size of our church so that, and then create multiple churches because that's what we want to do to impact the community at large. We think that small churches impact the community better than big churches do. That's not to say big churches are bad. Praise the Lord for them. Amen. They do great things. They do things that we can't do. But I believe that we
as a church will do best when we have multiple smaller churches of 300 than one church of 1,200 or 1,500. And it's really easy for numbers for us to get focused on. And when we get focused on these numbers, sometimes we entirely miss the point. Entirely miss the point. The point of why are we invitation? Why are we being invitation? Why should we make the effort? Why should we try and have people come here? Why? Let's talk about some of the reasons.
Matthew 14, we have Jesus who's talking to a group of people. And when Jesus talked, he oftentimes used parables. And he used these parables because it really communicated to people in a different way than just, hey, here's my first, second, third point. He was really good at it. So here's what he said. Jesus told them another parable. And the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. And when the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner and the servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you were pulling up the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let them both grow together until the harvest, and at that time I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds, tie them into bundles to be burned, and then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn." Verse 36, then he left the crowd and went into his house, and his disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us this parable of the weeds." He answered, "The one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. And the harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into a burning furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear." Jesus was telling this parable to the people to let them know this is what is coming. This is what is coming. There's coming a time when Jesus Christ will really come back, and he will send his angels into the world, and they will uproot all the evil that is in the world and destroy it. All that evil will be gathered together and destroyed. And it's not just evil in abstract, it's evil people. There's a coming judgment. Good and bad will stand before Jesus Christ. And a determination will be made. Will you be in the kingdom of God or not? Will you live forever with Jesus Christ in worship of the Father who will be God and he will be all and he will be in all? We don't even know what that means. Or will you be the one who's gathered together and is judged, is found wanting, is found not able to be in the presence of God because you're evil, because you did not receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and be thrown into the fire. John 14, 5 and 6, Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Because Jesus had just told him he's going to the Father. And Thomas says, "Well, we don't know. How do we get there?" And Jesus said this, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." You see, the first reason why we should be invitational is really simply this, because of the exclusivity of Jesus Christ. Jesus was completely and total and uncompromisingly exclusive. He said, "No one comes to the Father except by me." There's no other way to get to the kingdom of God. There's no other way to get to heaven except by me. Now, if I said that, that would be really narrow-minded, right? If I were going out and proclaiming, listen, the only way to get to heaven is to come to my church. The only way to get to heaven is to believe everything just like me. You know, if I said that, you should look at me and throw rocks at me. Okay? But I didn't say that. Jesus did. He's got the gravitas to say that. Not me. He does. And we have to take that seriously. One of the things that's going on in our culture is that there's this all this inclusiveness that happens. Well, you know, he really wasn't a Christian, so to speak, but he was really kind of a good guy, and he helped people. And he gave to that charity one time, and so I'm sure that he's got enough stuff. You know, they're probably good things in the good category. Yeah, he's got some bad stuff, but he's probably got enough to make it into heaven. That's what Jesus said. Jesus did say, hey, you know, as long as you've got enough good stuff and more good stuff than bad stuff, then you're in. That's a work salvation. We believe in unmerited grace, amen? It was Jesus Christ whose body was broken, whose blood was spilled. That's how we get into heaven. That's it. And people say, well, I don't believe that. I don't care. This is what Jesus said. You're not arguing with me. You're arguing with him. And the reality is that he was exclusive and he made no excuses for it. No excuses for it. You see, the reason we need to be invitational is because this is a matter of life and death. This isn't about building some church up. This is a matter of life and death. It's not about the numbers in our church or growing to certain places. It's not about helping people have better lives. Although, when you have Jesus in your life, you have a better life. That's not what it's about. It's not about that. It's that without Jesus Christ in your life, you're going to experience hell. You're going to be destroyed. It's God's preference, even his will, as his. It's my will that no one would perish. That's what God wants. That's what God's rooting for. He's rooting for everybody. So much so that he gave his son, his only son, so that the whole world might be saved. That's God's plan. But people are rejecting that. And the evil one is at work. And we can't just sit around and not get involved. We can't do it. There's no other area in our life where we would sit around and watch other people march off to their death. None. Not a single one of you would do it. I know who you are. Not a single one of you would sit there and watch a three-year-old walk out to the street and go, oh, this is pretty cool. Or, man, I'd go save the kid, but you know, I'm really busy. I'd stop him from going out in the street, but, man, I worked hard today. I don't think I can go out there. None of you would do that. None of you would do that. You would do anything you could to stop someone from experiencing death. And yet in this instance, sometimes what we do is we get so complacent because we forget that what it's really about is about life and death. We forget. We think it's about beliefs or it's about churches or it's about those kinds of things. That's not it. It's about life and death. That's what should motivate us. That's the number one reason that should motivate us. It should be screaming. There should be sirens going off in our head going, wow, this is about life and death. So we often fall into inclusiveness instead of realizing that Jesus could save someone. See, if we're not inviting people, it's because we've lost our sense of urgency. We've lost our sense of urgency. We've lost a sense of the importance. When I talk about inviting people to come to church, I want you to understand that coming to church is not the ultimate in sharing Christ. But here's what I do understand, that one of the very first opportunities that someone in the Bible had to share Christ, you know what they said? Three simple words. Come and see. The man went to his brother and said, come and see. I found Messiah. He didn't say, listen, I want to explain to you all these theological things. I want you to understand the whole entire Bible. Let me read it to you right now. Sit down. He didn't do any of that kind of stuff. He said, come and see. So when I'm talking about inviting people to church, that's what I'm talking about. It's not about, hey, come to my club. It's not, hey, come to my community or any of those kinds of things. Really what it is come and see Jesus. That's what I want you to do. When I'm talking about inviting, that's what I'm talking about. Come and see. Now, they might ask you questions about Jesus, and I really kind of suspect they will. But that's what it is. Come and see. And it's an issue of life or death. I could care less about numbers. The number I should be caring about is the number of people who will live and the number of people who will die. That's the issue. That's the issue. And I love them, and I don't want them to die. There's a second reason we need to be invitational. It's a matter of obedience to our Lord. It's a matter of obedience. Isn't it interesting that when Jesus sent out the disciples, he didn't give them an option? He didn't give them an option. Listen, this is what he says in Matthew chapter 10. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. This was because Jesus at this time was going to the Israel first. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near, or is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely you are to give. So Jesus didn't tell his disciples, listen, hey, if you feel like evangelism is your spiritual calling, then I'm going to send you out. That's what he said. He didn't say, listen, if you feel like, you know, you're an outgoing person and you could maybe invite somebody to church, then maybe you could occasionally do that. Go ahead. That's what he said. And you know what? None of the disciples went to Jesus and said, hey, Jesus, listen, I know you're wanting to send us out to the lost people in Israel and everything, but I've got such a busy week. You have no idea the kind of stuff that I've got to do. Peter, my mother-in-law's bugging me about the yard work. I've been gone. I've been following you around. You can't believe it. I really can't go out this week, Jesus. Maybe next week. Listen, I'll give up my calendar and let's talk. Or maybe, you know, Jesus, I would go out and invite people. I would go out and go out into the lost tribes of Israel and all this kind of stuff. I mean, that's really good motivation and everything. Can we, like, have a missions week so we can all go together? Nobody said that. Maybe you can think that, well, I can just maybe skip over that part because that was really not for us because Jesus was sending the disciples. So then we get to Matthew 28 so that you just don't get lost in that too much. Matthew 28, 16 says, then the 11 disciples went to Galilee. This is after Jesus had been resurrected. And he went to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And then there they saw him and they worshipped him. But some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. So Jesus, talking to the disciples, the resurrected Jesus, talking to his disciples, says, go and make disciples of all nations, all peoples. Go make disciples. In Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. See, Jesus gave this command to the disciples, but there's no doubt that it goes beyond that. Is it? There's no doubt that the command applies to us because this is the mission of the church, and it was not a suggestion, it was a command. It was a command. And so we have this really difficult reality that we have to face, that if we're not out inviting people and telling them about Jesus Christ, we're being disobedient to our Lord and Savior. We're being disobedient.
we're telling him, no, I won't do that.
Tom Rainer wrote this great book called The Church Next Door. I've been reading, finished reading and read it at the leadership class. This is what he says. This lack of spiritual growth inevitably leads to a diminished desire to share Christ with others. Lack of spiritual growth inevitably leads to a diminished desire to share Christ with others. Put it another way, the reason we're not sharing Jesus Christ with other people is because we're not growing spiritually ourselves. And if you want an indication as to whether or not people are growing spiritually, look at whether or not they're sharing Jesus Christ with other people. If they're not sharing Jesus Christ with other people, they're not growing spiritually. Because when you are in touch with the Holy Spirit, when you are growing in Jesus Christ, you're going to be sharing what you have because you're not going to be able to contain it. You're going to be telling other people about it. And if you're not, you're probably not growing spiritually. Here's the reality. If you're spiritually dry and dusty, if you're lethargic, can't seem to get motivated, can't seem to be doing the things that God is calling you to do, then one of the first things that are going to go in your Christian life is sharing the gospel with anyone else. That's the reality. It'll make you tired just thinking about it. You'll be saying, you'll yawn and say, man, let me get back in a pop-up line. And thinking about sharing Jesus Christ with people, but that's way too much for me. You know what Jesus never said? Lots of things, presumably, amen. But what he never said this was, he never said, bring your friends to church. Jesus never said that. There's no quote in there. There's no church, there's no quote in here that said, invite your friends to church. Now, we can take that a lot of different ways. You know, any kind of argument from silence is somewhat suspect. But he didn't exclude your friends. Right? He wasn't, because Jesus didn't say invite your friends to church, he wasn't saying, well, that means that you need to exclude friends. Don't do anything with friends. That's not the point. But he expected and commanded that we would go out into the world and share Jesus. That we're his representatives, his ambassadors. We're to be his witnesses in all the world. Here's the alarming fact. Jesus had in mind that we would invite complete strangers to church. Isn't that alarming? I don't know if that's alarming to you, but it probably is. That Jesus had in mind that you would go out and you would invite complete strangers to church. You see, one of the reasons why I think we've kind of gotten stagnated sometimes in not inviting people to church is because I say things like this, hey, bring your friends to church. And you're thinking, yeah, I got four friends. I already invited them. 1, 2, 3. Yep, I invited them like 4 years ago. I don't really have any more friends than that. So I guess I'm done. Good enough. Hey, I invited my friends to church, Pastor. They didn't want to come, but I just invited them. And every once in a while, I bug them when we're doing something fun. But then they didn't want to come, and so I guess I'm done. I accomplished the mission that God had in mind for me. No. God had in mind for you that you would be his ambassador all the time, not just to your friends. Maybe to your friends first. But that you would be invitational to complete, utter strangers. And you would invite them to come and see Jesus. That's what God had in mind. That's what Jesus had in mind. We would invite complete strangers to church. Now, sometimes we preachers like to make things easy. We like to make the path real straight. And so maybe by me saying, hey, bring your friends to church, you fought that. Oh, well, I asked my friends, they don't want to come, and I'm all done. If the kingdom of God is limited to our friends, we're in deep trouble. Amen? It's going to be a small place. We need to bring an acquaintance to church. Amen? That's what we need to do. So next time I just say, hey, we're having a potluck. Don't bring a friend. Bring an acquaintance. In fact, what I need to say is, hey, we're having a potluck next week. Bring a complete stranger that you just talked to at the Subaru place or the Nissan place, bring them to church. The people you meet here and there, the people that you meet, maybe the mechanic, maybe you had jury duty with them, maybe you worked at the same plant, maybe you need to invite them and bring them to church. And we need to even go further. And invite strangers to church. You might even have to do things on purpose in order to encounter the situations where you can invite someone to church. I love to fish. But if I fish in my backyard, there's very little opportunity. Funny enough, there is some opportunity. I have one fish in a hot tub in my backyard. And so it is only one left. And so if I fish in my backyard, I might catch one fish. But I don't want to catch it because I keep him there to grow my garden. So what I have to do is I actually have to leave my home and I have to go out to Lake Devereux to catch a fish. And you know what else? I have to leave the bank and go out in a boat. Yeah, I mean really. The work that I have to do to go catch a fish. If I had this weird idea that if I just wait here at this exact right moment, something will come along and a fish will somehow be caught. If I just stay right here in the lake and I don't even move, I just stay right here, that at some point in the time-space continuum, that a fish will swim by and I'll catch it. I will probably be waiting a very long time. If you are waiting around for that perfect moment to invite someone to church, that all the stars are going to align and you're going to say, hey, I've never been to church. And look at you. And you can say, oh, this is it. This is the moment I've been waiting for. You're going to be waiting for a long time. It's not the way it works. I was talking to Glenn this week about being invitational. And Glenn said this. He said, hey, listen, I got three things that are working against me. I told him I was going to say this. It's all right. I didn't tell him what I was going to say about it. So he's a little nervous. But he told me these three things. He said, one, he works from home. Fishing in your backyard. Don't work very good. He said, number two, most of his clients are out of state. They're national clients. So he would invite the people from North Carolina to come to church, but they probably wouldn't do it. And he said, number three, he lives 45 minutes away. And invited people from way down there on the end of Long Branch. It's not the end of the world, you can see it, that's Olympia. But he said, way down there, at the end of the world, he said, inviting them 45 minutes, it's tough to get them to come 45 minutes to the church. To which I say, amen. Glenn is going to have to do some extraordinary things to find people to invite the church. It's not going to happen that they're going to come up his driveway and he's going to encounter complete strangers in his yard, and he's going to have the opportunity to invite them to church. He's going to have to get out of there. He's going to have to leave, go over two bridges, just to get into an area where he might be able to invite somebody to church. He might have to plan trips into town. He might have to go to a park. He might have to go to a baseball game or a basketball game. He might have to do all kinds of things because of the disadvantages that he mentioned. He might have to do some of these things to actually be able to accomplish what Christ has said to do. That's why Jesus didn't say, stay here and all the nations will come to you and then you can make disciples of them. He said to the disciples, you've got to go and make disciples. We've got to be deliberate. And he doesn't get to say, well, God, here's the three things I got working against me, so I would have invited people to church. But I got these three things. You see, you probably got your list, and I got my list, right? Oh, I don't like to talk to strangers. Okay, stranger danger. Never really got over that. Or whatever the thing is. Right? You might have your list, but the deal is this. The reason we are inviting is not because we want to. It's not because we're trying to build something up. It's because Jesus Christ commanded us to go. That's the reason. He commanded us to go. And if we don't go, we're looking you in the face and we're saying, no. You know, I'll do all this stuff, but that, no. There's the line. Not going to do that. You might actually have to schedule a time every week when you go to a playground as a mom, and maybe you're going to sit on a bench and you're going to let your kids play, and what you're really doing is you're praying, God, I'm going to invite somebody from this playground to church today. So I'm going to sit here, so you just bring the right person in to my life right now that I can invite into church. Because that's what I'm here for. Kids will be playing, mom will come sit down and say, you know what? I have this great church, I'd like you to come. A police stranger, never met him, just on the playground. You might have to join a bowling league. Wear goofy shoes, bad shirts. Right? Just so that you can have an opportunity to throw a round ball at some wooden pins. And as you play different teams, you find somebody, and you might find, you know, Sam, the guy that works down the street, and he's on the bowling league too, and say, hey, Sam, come to my church. You might have to do that. Just to be able to strike up a conversation. We have to learn how to trust and rely on the Holy Spirit. We do that in part when we pray and ask Him to guide us to the person that He wants us to invite. That's what we've got to do. God, I'm going to the park, and my only reason is to have this opportunity, so please encourage me and give me just the right person you want me to invite. Next week, I'm going to Bremerton because the little seat on my seat heater, on Susan's seat heater, mine works fine, she broke hers. And so we got to go there and get that little switch fixed. They had to order it in. And I'm going to have to sit there for an hour. I'm not going to read a book. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to be looking for the person that God is going to guide me to invite to our church. Or I'm going to look for the person whom I can share Jesus Christ with. That's what I'm looking for. There's a guy by the name of Dennis that goes down to the Lake Devereaux. I've been down to Lake Devereaux and I found him there 3 or 4 or 5 times. And every time I struck up a conversation with Dennis, one of these days, next time I go to Lake Devereaux, I find Dennis there. I'm going to invite Dennis to come to church. He lives in Silverdale. I know all kinds of things about Dennis. I hope you get to meet him. One of these days, he's walking in here and he's saying, hey, you're Dennis. He's going to freak out. But I'm going to invite him to church. The reality is, why I'm doing that is because Jesus has commanded me to go tell people to come and see. That's why. And I want to be obedient to my Savior. I want to be obedient to my Savior. And I want to finish with this last reason. We should be invited because people in our community need a community. They need church. They need church. Jesus walked through and he says they're like sheep without a shepherd. They're just running all over the place. They don't know what the world they're doing. They're bumping into things. You ever seen a sheep without a shepherd? They're a hazard to themselves and others. They really are. And, you know, when everything's going well, when the lights in your life are turning green and they turn out right, people don't feel a need for church. They really don't. When all the ducks are in a row and the stock market is up and the job is secure, you think the stock market was down on Friday, wait till Monday. And you know, everything is going, health is spectacular. Everything's going great. People don't need a church. At least that's what they think. In fact, they don't even believe they need God. Matthew 19 says this, just then a man came up to Jesus and said, teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life? See, he had the good things in mind. Why do you ask me about what is good? Jesus replied, there's only one who is good. If you want to enter life, keep the commandments. Which ones? He inquired. Jesus replied, you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother and love your neighbor as yourself. All of these I have kept, said the young man. What do I still lack? He sensed that something was missing. And Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. When the young man heard this, he went away sad, because he had great wealth. And then Jesus said to his disciples, truly I tell you, it is harder for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven.
Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who's rich to enter the kingdom of God. When the disciples heard this, they were greatly astonished. They said, well, then who can be saved? And Jesus said, with man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. The people in our country, the people that you are interacting with, the people that you've been inviting to church are rich. They're rich. Now, they don't drive the latest and greatest. They maybe don't come to church in a helicopter. Right? They're probably not rich like that. But when you stop and think about all the things we have in this country and all the things that we just assume, when you stop and think about the security that we have in this place, we're rich. Now, many of the blessings we have in this country are because the founders of our country based our country on godly principles and on Jesus Christ. They were godly men. And so as a result of that, the documents and the system of government, all those things reflected that, and God's blessing has been upon our country. When we base anything on God's revealed will for humanity, it turns out pretty good. But when we begin to move away from that, then the results and the consequences are both predictable and tragic, aren't they? People are rich in our country. And our country is rich in so many ways, but we're quickly moving away from God's principles in every area of life. And the results are going to be tragic in consequence. And tragic consequences, and they're going to be immediate, and you're going to start seeing things as things begin to fall apart. It's happening in the family, it's happening in economics, all of these things. It's just happening because people are moving away from what God has said. And the consequences will fall. And people will suddenly face very difficult and challenging circumstances. And isn't it amazing how when they do that, they begin to look to the church. They begin to look in the church. And when they do, we will not be like the older brother of the story of that merciful father who was looking for his prodigal son. That older brother who said, I'm not going to join the party. I was here all along. We're not going to be like that. We're going to be the people that are here going, let's celebrate with you. You finally came in. It took your whole life falling apart, but you finally came in. And you're here. Praise God. That's what we're going to be like. But how much better is it to have a relationship with God? How much better is it to have a church family that can hold you and support you and surround you and become all around you before you have all those troubles come? Amen? How much better is it to have this incredible, great church family that will love you and care for you in the good times and the bad times and support you no matter what before you hit the hard times? Because when the hard times come, you don't have very much inside. Amen? But man, if you've got people around you that can give you a hug and love you and say, man, that is so great, and give you some food and do whatever it is we can do as a church body. There are people out there that are so lonely and so alone. We need to invite them to be a part of this. Not for us, for them. Maybe everything's going great in their life, but it's not going to stay that way. It never does. The rain falls on the evil and the good. Amen? It will come. And we want them to be a part of this and have this relationship. They need a community. So we should be inviting them. We should be invitational. Come join us. So there's three reasons. There's a lot more, but here's the three. Jesus is the only way. Without Jesus Christ, people are going to go to hell. They're going to experience destruction. They're going to face their God and have nothing to say. It's a matter of life and death. It's not about us. It's not about our comfort zone. It's about their life. I don't care how quiet you are. If you saw a three-year-old running in the street, you would scream for all your worth. It's a matter of life and death. It's a command from Christ. It wasn't a suggestion. Oh, you know, I think it'd be a really good idea if you invite somebody to Apollo. It was a command from Christ who said, listen, go out into the world and make disciples. Bring them in here. Yes, come and see. It doesn't even stop there. You know what? If we bring a whole bunch of people in here, we're going to have to disciple them. You're going to have to disciple them. You know how many people I can disciple? Small number. You're going to have to do that. It wasn't a suggestion, it was a command from Jesus Christ. How dare us to say to Jesus, no! And look around. This world's a train wreck. You walk through the store and you just see it. You know, I often talk about walking through Albertsons. It's not that Albertsons has bad people. It's that Albertsons has everybody, right? Everybody needs food. And so you go in there and you see all walks of life, and you just see people that, and you just see kids. There's some kids, I just want to hug them. I just go, oh man. Because you can see the kind of life they've got. And you see some people that are just so broken. And you just want to hug them. And you just want to say, man, if you came to our church, we'd love you, and we'd care for you, and this would be the great place for you. And you can let all that stuff go and you can be healed. That's what should drive us. They need Jesus. They need a place. There's all kinds of reasons why we don't invite. Sometimes we're afraid that we'll be rejected. Sometimes we're afraid that they'll be aggressive towards us. So we're going to have to put all that aside. And here's what we're going to do. I think we as a church need to understand that we're not being invitational. Let's be real. We're not being invitational. You know what I know? From Tom Rainer's book, he said that about 82% of people are somewhat likely to come to church if we invited them to church. Somewhat likely. Now that's not a guarantee, but they're somewhat likely to come. They'll consider it. They might come. If we invite them personally. There's 35 adults in our church. If 35 adults invited one person a week, that's over 1,800 invitations in the course of a year. If you only invited one person a week, but all 35 of us did it, that's 1,800. If only half of those people, not 82%, but if only half of them came, that's 910 guests that would come through our doors in a year. Wow. I can tell you for a fact we've never had 910 guests in a year. We're not being invitational. And if only 2% of the 910 people that came through our door said, you know what? This is a pretty good place. I think I'll stick around. We would have more guests than we have members right now in a year. We'd be a church of about 81 people. After 1 year, of all the adults invited one person per week. That's it. And you know, after 3 years, we'd be busting the doors out. We'd be at two services. We wouldn't fit in here, even if we filled up all the way back to the back wall. It means that we're not inviting. So what are we going to do? Well, first we've got to confess that we're not being invitational. That's the reality, right? We've just got to look in the mirror and say, you know what, God? I've disobeyed you. I didn't take it as serious as I needed to. These people in the community, I didn't do it. I'm not doing it. I did it once in a while when conditions were just right, but I'm not doing it. So we need to confess that before God. But then there's the second thing we need to do. We need to build a habit of inviting someone to church once a week. I'm not trying to make a gimmick. When you try and build a habit, it's hard, right? It's hard to build a habit. And so what you have to do is you have to force yourself to do the thing over and over again. They say like 21 times you have to do it before it's actually a habit. And then if you quit for like 2 weeks, you're done. You got to do it again to build the habit. We need to build the habit, build the ethos, build the culture, build the skills, build the over and over and over and over, doing it again, of inviting people once a week. And we're not going to be able to do it sitting at home.
We're going to have to actually go on purpose and go fishing somewhere other than our backyard, because guess what? Strangers are not showing up in our backyard unless we've got a really weird backyard. So we're going to have to go and deliberately do something that is going to allow us to invite one person a week to church. Not because church is the end-all be-all, but because we're going to say, come and see. So my hope is it's the beginning of a conversation, not the last part of the conversation. So I'm going to challenge you to do that. And you're going to have to pray, God, help me get out of my comfort zone. God, lead me to someone that I can invite, whether they're at the Shell station or wherever they're at. God, where do you want me to go? Invite. Where is that? And I'm going to challenge you to do it, and we're going to do even more. This week I was sending some things out to young adults, a few of you, just to give me some input. And I came up with two little tools. One is a little card that says, Saturdays at 3:30 p.m., Wellspring Fellowship, and it's got a web page on it. It's not complicated. It's also not complete. This is not an invitation. You don't get to put this on somebody's window and go, whoop, I accomplished it. What this is this is something that somebody can attach a refrigerator to so that they don't forget what time church is. Or, what's the name of your church again? You ever heard that before? Right? Wellspring Fellowship is not simple. We don't say, where do you go? The Rock. You know, everybody knows The Rock. Okay, that's great. But Wellspring Fellowship is, what? What was that again? It's Fellowship of the Ring. What? And so they're trying to understand what their church is. And so what we're going to do is we're going to give them this card and say, yeah, this church, this is the one I want you to come to. But it's about the personal conversation. This is a tool after the personal conversation where you're inviting somebody to church. I mean, another one's kind of hip. It's kind of cool, right? I'm saying that as an old person. So you can look at it and see whether that's the case or not. And you can choose which one you'd like to give the person. Maybe you're not going to give a card at all. That's fine. That's fine. But I just want to make a couple of tools, and we're actually going to make a lot of tools, so that we can get in the habit of inviting one person a week to church. Now, it'd be really easy for me to say, okay, we got these cards, and I'm going to put them in the back, and everybody, y'all just take one, and you invite somebody this week to church. But I have found that when you are building a new habit, especially a habit that is getting us out of our comfort zone, that we've got to get out of our comfort zone to build. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to challenge you. If you will commit to inviting somebody to church this week, I'm going to invite you to come up and get a card. And what we're going to do is we're going to gather together all right here, all the people that are saying, yeah, I'll invite somebody to church this week. And we're going to pray over these. And I'm going to pray over you. So what that's going to mean is that if you say, yeah, Pastor, that was a good sermon, I'm going to invite somebody to church this week and take one on the out. That's one way of doing it, right? That'd be nice and easy. Y'all be real comfortable with that. But what I'm going to do is, I'm not going to do that. We're going to go out of the comfort zone. And so here's what I'm going to ask you to do is that if you will commit to inviting one person to church this week, I'm going to ask you to come up here and get a card so I can pray for you. Now, some of you might be saying, I don't think I'm going to do that. Okay. I don't want you to come up front if you're not going to. This isn't about pressure, it's about accountability. This is about an opportunity for people to say, you know what, I'm willing to do that. And I will make that commitment. So if you're not willing to do that, don't do it because I'm pushing you. I want to pray for us, and I want to get you out of the comfort zone. Here's the deal. If you're uncomfortable to come up front and be prayed for and get a card, you're probably too uncomfortable to invite somebody to church. Amen? This is probably the first step. There's going to be other steps you're going to have to take, but this one's really, really important. And we're going to pray over these and over the people that are holding these cards, that they will have that opportunity to invite just the right person, the person that God is putting in their life. And if that opportunity doesn't come in their backyard, that they'll have the courage to go out and do that. But I want to tell you something else. We're going to do the same thing next week. And we're going to do the same thing the week after that. We're going to do the same thing the week after that. The week after that. Until being invitational is ingrained in who we are as Wellspring Fellowship. You see, that's the key.
This isn't a gimmick. This isn't a program. This isn't some kind of, you know, this is how we're going to do it. What I'm inviting you to do is be part of building a new habit in your life. So here's what I want you to do. If you're willing to make that commitment to invite somebody to church next week and come up here and get a car, come over here, and we're going to have some prayer. I've got one. It's in my pocket. Bremerton is happening. Who's going to join with me? Come on. You can invite anybody you like. And here's the thing, there's no, don't pick somebody one for somebody else. If you're going to get one, you come get one. Be taken to people that they would be made well. Lord, we're going to pray over these cards. And I just pray, Lord, that they would have the impact that you have in mind. That not just them, that they only represent our efforts. So, Lord, as we go out and we invite people to church this next week, no matter where it is, no matter how it happens, I just pray that your hand would be in it. And, Lord, as we're going to do this every single week until the habit is ingrained in us, I just pray that you begin to bless these efforts because, God, we want to be obedient to you. It's a matter of life and death. People need what we have. And so I pray, Lord, that you would encourage us, inspire us, lift us up as we invite people to this church and invite them to come and see. Holy Spirit, guide us. And I pray that you would just bless us with the fruit that comes, not for our sake, God, but for theirs and for yours. I thank you and I praise you in Jesus' name.